In this video, we're going to cover the basics of polar plots. Polar plots allow us to analyze the performance of an airfoil in terms of lift, drag, moment, and transition from laminar to turbulent. Let's get to it. This video will cover the basics of creating polar plots. Another video will be coming out to show you more advanced technique when dealing with polar plots, so keep an eye out for that. So we've covered a lot of these first steps in other videos, so I'm going to go over these first steps pretty quickly. The first step is to load an airfoil into Xfoil. For this tutorial, I'm going to be using the NACA 4412 airfoil, so I'll just type in NACA 4412. The second step would be to clean up the paneling of this airfoil. I'm just going to use the default paneling parameters by typing in pane at the command prompt so that it uses the default parameters to repanel the airfoil. The third step would be to navigate to the menu where the analysis is done. This is the direct operating points menu. To get to this menu, I just type oper at the command prompt and hit enter. Step four would be to increase the maximum number of iterations that the analysis will perform when trying to get the solution to converge. We haven't actually covered this one yet in any of the videos. It's a new command, but it is a highly recommended command. When trying to figure out a solution, Xfoil is iterating and trying to converge on the correct answer. The maximum number of iterations is the number of times that Xfoil will try and solve the problem before giving up. Now, Xfoil's default value, I feel, is really too low for the computers we have nowadays. So I would definitely increase this value on a normal basis for every analysis that I do. And for this one that we're doing here, I'm just gonna go ahead and increase it to about 250. I do that by typing ITER at the command prompt, followed by the number of iterations I want to be as the maximum limit. So in this case, 250, and just hit enter. The next step would be to turn on the viscous mode and provide the Reynolds number that you want the analysis to be performed at. So at the command prompt, just type visc and then the Reynolds number. I went ahead and chose 3 million for this analysis. The next step would be to toggle what graph is going to be displayed when you run an analysis. Now, the default for Xfoil is that when you run an analysis, it's going to display the pressure distribution plot. And what we're going to do right here is change what plot Xfoil is going to create when we run an analysis. And we do that using the SEQP command. If you type that in your command prompt and hit enter, you'll see that it prints out a line to the command prompt that says polar will be plotted during point sequence. This is just telling us that we toggled from the pressure distribution plot to now it's going to be displaying the polar plot when we run our analysis. If we want to switch back to the pressure distribution plot, we just use this exact same command. Type it in and hit enter, then you'll see that it will say the CPX, or the pressure distribution plot, will be plotted during point sequence. So this essentially just switches back and forth between the polar plot and the pressure distribution plot. The next step would be to toggle on the polar point accumulation. Now, if you forget this step and you try to perform a sequence of alphas using the ASEQ command, the asequence command, you'll notice that the polar plots are not actually generated. The reason for this is that Xfoil's default is to not accumulate or not store the results from previous analysis. So by using this command, the PACC, what we are doing is we are telling Xfoil that we want it to store the values of each analysis run that we do. So for different angle of attacks or different coefficient of lifts. And when we do that, it's going to then be able to display on our polar plots all of the different values. Now it's going to ask you for a couple of file names. At this point, don't worry about it. We're not going to be getting into the files in this video. We're going to save what those files are for the polar plots advanced video that's coming out shortly. So when it asks you for the polar save file name or the polar dump file name, just hit enter without entering a file name. And as you can see there at the bottom, Xfoil prompts us and tells us that the polar accumulation has been enabled. So now when we run a sequence of angle of attack or a sequence of coefficient of lift, Xfoil will store the value and we'll be able to see it on the plot. Now we're done setting up Xfoil and we're ready to run our analysis. At this point, we need to tell Xfoil the angle of attack or angle of attacks or the coefficient of lift or coefficients of lift that we want the analysis run at. We can use either individual commands where we do a single angle of attack or a single coefficient of lift, or we can use the sequence command to automate this process, which would run a number of different angle of attacks or a number of different coefficient of lifts. Now, some people like to do it individually because then you can watch it as it iterates through and see how it converges, how many iterations it took to converge. A quick note, if you're wanting to do an individual angle of attack or an individual coefficient of lift at a time, remember that we enabled polar accumulation. So as you run each individual angle of attack or coefficient of lift, it's going to store the result of each of those runs into the memory with the rest of the analysis. Now, the way that Xfoil is going to generate the plot is that it is going to draw a line between the previous point and the next point. What this means if you're running individual analysis is that you are wanting to go in order, or you're going to see some funkiness with the lines. It's going to jump between the wrong points and not go in the correct order. There is a way to fix that. If you don't do it, you can display the list of your different points and sort it, but we'll cover that in the advanced polar plot video. So at this point, I would recommend one of these sequence commands to make sure that you're going in the correct order and covering all the angle of attacks that you're wanting to. Or if you run them individually, just make sure you start at one end and sweep through all your values in order. For this analysis, I'm going to use the sequence of angle of attack command, which is the ASEQ command, to automatically sweep through the angle of attacks that I'm wanting to perform an analysis on. Now, when using either the alpha sequence or coefficient of lift sequence, it's going to ask for three values. It's going to ask first for the starting value, it's going to ask second for the ending value, and the third value is it's going to ask for an increment. For this analysis, I'm wanting to do a range of angle of attack from -8 to 26, and I'm wanting to do it at every 1 degree point. So at -8 and -7, -6, -5, all the way up, 24, 25, 26. So to do that, I'm going to enter -8 for the first alpha value, 26 for the last alpha value, and 1 for the increment between runs, and hit enter. You'll see the plot there on the right is what you will get when you do this. And if you notice, the lines actually overrun the plot boundaries. This is probably one of my biggest pet peeves in Xfoil. So next we're going to look at how we can fix the plot so that these lines stay in the graph. So the command that you use to adjust the axes limits is the PPAX command. Polar plot axes command is what I believe that stands for, PPAX. This plot is going to give you the option of changing the minimum, maximum, and the increment value for the four different axes. The first of which is the angle of attack axes. Now we'll actually prompt you and show you what the current values are so that you have a good idea of how you need to tweak them. Now you may notice when you first type in this command that it does not prompt you for the new values. It'll just print a line with the current values in it and then give you a blank line where you can enter the new values. And it will do this one at a time for each axis. So if you want to type PPAX at the command prompt and hit enter, it's going to print out alpha, min, max, delta, and give you the current values. Now, since my analysis was a sequence of alphas from -8 to 26, I'm going to be using similar values for the alpha axis limits. So I went ahead and used -10 as the min, I used 25 for the max, and I chose a delta of 5 degrees. So if you enter those into the blank line and hit enter, you will see that it will then prompt you for the coefficient of lift axes limits. So I went ahead and chose the values you see there on the screen. You just enter the values in individually with a space between the values and hit enter, and it will change the current values to the values you type on that line. Do the same thing with the coefficient of drag. Now, what is interesting here is if you look at the moment coefficient axes, you'll see a negative sign, and this is because the moment coefficient is actually plotted upside down, with the coefficient of lift of zero line being the same as the moment coefficient of zero line. For the moment plot, the negative values are actually going up. Now, what this actually means is that the minimum value there is going to be at the top of the plot. The max value is going to be towards the bottom of the plot, and then the delta is going to be the spacing between the lines. So go ahead and type in those numbers and hit enter. After you've changed these axes parameters, you're going to need to replot the polar, and you can do that with the PPLO command, the polar plot command, and it will replot the polar with the new axes on it. Now, don't feel bad if you need to run through changing the axis limits and then replotting, changing the axis limits, replotting. Don't feel bad if you got to do it a few times until you get the plot to look good. All right, so let's take a quick look at the drag polar, which would be the coefficient of lift versus the coefficient of drag. This plot is usually used when you know a lift coefficient and you're trying to find out the corresponding drag. Now, because of this, some people mistakenly think that the coefficient of lift is actually the independent variable, and they'll be adamant about switching the axes so that the coefficient of lift is the x-axis and the coefficient of drag would be the y-axis. That's not entirely accurate. The coefficient of lift, coefficient of drag, moment coefficient are functions of alpha, Reynolds number, Mach number, airfoil shape. So it doesn't really matter if the coefficient of lift is the x-axis or the y-axis. While we're on the subject of the axes, pay close attention to the coefficient of drag axis. Xfoil uses some funny units for that. It will actually scale up the value. So when you see a 1000 value on the coefficient of drag axis, that is actually a coefficient of drag of 0.1. This is especially important if you're trying to adjust the limits of the axes, because the command to change the limits is looking for the real value, whereas if you're just looking at the plot, it's looking at a scaled up version. Now, because the coefficient of lift and the coefficient of drag on this plot are scaled by the same parameters, you can actually determine the lift to drag ratio by dividing the lift coefficient by the drag coefficient. You can also find the best lift to drag ratio with a line that starts at the origin and rotating it clockwise until it first touches the line. That first point where it is tangential to the line is where you're going to get your best lift to drag ratio. You can find out what your minimum coefficient of drag is. Now, when creating these polars, you'll find that if you're flying really fast, you'll want to create a bunch of different polars for different Mach numbers, and you can compare them or interpolate between the different plots. However, if you're flying slower, oftentimes you're going to want to have a family of different Reynolds numbers that you ran through. Then, of course, if you're looking at different airplane configurations, you might have a plot with flaps deployed, with flaps not deployed, with slats deployed, with slats not deployed. So you'll create a different family of polar plots for that. So the middle plot that Xfoil plots is the lift curve plot, or the lift polar. It's also combined with the moment polar, but we'll talk about that on the next slide. For the lift polar, this would be the lift coefficient for a given angle of attack, or the angle of attack for a given lift coefficient. You can get a lot of information from this plot. You can see where the alpha of zero lift is. So if you have a cambered airfoil, that's going to be a non-zero value. You have a linear region where you can get the slope. You can also look to determine where your maximum lift coefficient is. The angle at which you hit your maximum lift coefficient is also your stall angle. You can look a little bit past stall to see what the nature of stall is. Is it a gentle stall? Is it a sharp stall? But then, of course, you have the slope of the lift curve This is using a lot of equations for aerodynamics and for flight control, stability and control type of analysis. So the middle plot that Xfoil plots is also the moment polar. This would be the moment coefficient versus angle of attack. The reference point, of course, is the 25% of the chord. This is usually where your aerodynamic center lives. If you're wanting more information on that, check out the aerodynamic series on my channel. And as I mentioned on an earlier slide, this plot is actually flipped. So it will plot the negative values going up. I think this is because negative values are good because it gives you a pitch down moment, which means that for a disturbance that causes you to pitch up, the airplane's gonna naturally wanna pitch down. So this is kind of a stable condition. And so we typically want this value to be negative, which is probably why they in here flip the plot and put the negative values upwards. It's just a matter of convention. I never really did this in my studies. We usually just left it with it being underneath the lift curve slope, which I like a lot better because it's less cluttered and easier to read. But this is the way Xfoil does it. So the last plot in the polar plots that Xfoil creates is a transition plot. So this would be showing where on the chord that the flow transitions from laminar to turbulent for a given coefficient of lift. So the coefficient of lift is actually the y-axis in all three plots, not including the moment coefficient plot. Now the x-axis would be the location on the chord. And as you can see there, it is the transition point normalized by the chord. So this is just telling you where on the chord it transitions. So 20%, 30%, 60%. Now it has both the upper surface and the lower surface. If you look towards the left of the plot, the upper surface is always going to be on top, the lower surface is going to be on the bottom. All right, we're going to go ahead and end the video here. In this video, we covered the basics of polar plots. Stay tuned for a future video where we will cover advanced topics for polar plots. Remember, like, comment, subscribe, and share this with your fellow classmates. I will see you in the next video.